Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. So now we are going to have lecture number 6, that is formatting and PCM waveforms. Up until now, up till previous lecture, we have covered analog to digital conversion, which was basically converting a totally analog signal into a digital one. So for today's lecture, we are going to have the topic that is formatting and PCM waveforms. And the concepts that are going to be covered in this lecture is formatting the textual data, which is basically the character coding. And then we have got a way of transmission or way of representing this logical data into actual voltages, that is PCM waveforms, which include non-return to zero, return to zero, phase encoded, and multi-level binary. Just to give you a reminder that this lecture is basically made from Bernard-Clark, that is chapter number 2 of Bernard-Clark. So you have to cover section 2.1 and 2.1 of this book, and then section 2.8.1 to through 2.8.5 of 1. So moving on to the formatting, if you look at this first block that is labeled in bold outline, we have got this block which is formatting, which is basically the part of any communication system. Up until now, we have been dealing with the sources where the original information is basically in totally analog format, and we need to convert that analog format to digital format in order to be able to transmit that information digitally. But that is not the case every time. So if we have the analog information, we can sample it, we can quantize it, we can encode it, and we can convert this analog information to digital information, which is basically the bit stream here, by following the analog to digital conversion. But every time you do not have a signal that is purely in analog format, but there are certain sources which can generate information in formats other than the analog format. So one format is basically the digital format. So if we have any device or any source of information which is creating information in the form of bits, then we do not need to do anything with that. So if we have the digital information, the digital information does not need to be processed for any type of conversion, and we can directly send it for the further parts of the transmitter so that it can be transmitted. So, but there are sources which fall in the third category, which is basically when they are generating the information which is textual in nature. A very common or daily life example is your computers. Computers or your devices, your mobile phones, your PDAs, and other information, other sources which generate the information which in principle is in textual information, textual format. You need to convert that textual format into something that is known as the digital information. So in principle, we have three sources of information. We have three categories of sources. One is the analog source, where you have to convert the analog signal into a digital one. The other one is the digital information. You do not need to process anything for this, because it is already in the digital format. We are going to cover this the method when the way we are going to convert the textual information to digital information. So moving on, let's say whenever you press any character key on your laptop or your phone, you are basically pressing A, B, C, or any other alphabet in principle, or any other character to be precise. But this is not something that your computer sees. Your computer does not see the word A or the alphabet A. It sees the binary meaning of it. So when I say I am pressing an A on the laptop keyboard, I am doing that. I am going to have the character which is A, but computer is going to see it as a sequence of bits. So how do we convert this character into sequence of it bits is basically given by the character coding, which is basically the most used format in character coding, is basically American Standard Code for Information Interchange, or to in a short form we call it the ASCII table. You might be aware of it, but just have a look through it again. So let's say if I'm pressing, let me move on to the state, to the example. Let's say we are going to have a word thing that we are going to press on our laptop, and we want to convert this word into the sequence of pairs. So we are going to use the ASCII table. Generally, the ASCII table is giving you the 7-bit equivalent of the character, which means for every character there are 7 bits which are defined. And but in computers we use the information that is in digital format in the form of bytes, which means 8 bits. So an 8th bit is added to the 7 bits, which is basically the parity bit. So whenever you are going to have an ASCII character code, the most used format is, it is 8 bit, where first 7 bits are for the character codes and the 8th bit is for parity. Now depending upon even parity or the odd parity, you are going to have that bit as 0 or 1, and that is totally a separate topic. But just to give you a quick summary, parity bits are added to detect the error in the sequence of bits. So we can use two types of parities, and one is even parity, the other one is odd parity. So moving back to our example where we were going to convert the word think into bit stream. So let's say we have got T here. For T we have bits 0010, which is bits number 1, 2 and 3 and 4, and then we have got 101, which is bits 5, 6 and 7. So if I want to convert this T into the digital format, I need to have 0010 and 101 as 7 bits. So depending upon even parity or odd parity, I am going to add an 8th bit into this thing. Similar is the case with the word H. So if I go for H here, H is, so the first 4 bits are 0001 and the last 3 bits are 001, and the 8 bit would be your parity bit. Following the same situation, I can convert the word I can convert the word N, and I can convert the word K. So this is how American Standard Code for Information Interchange is basically used to encode characters into digital bits. Now if you look at this table, we are not having only the alphabets here, we are having the numbers here from 0 to 9. We are having alphanumeric characters, we are having all types of situations here. Here it is enter, the key that you press on your laptop or your mobile. This is delete key, and you have escape key, and you have all the keys that could be defined on this table. So if I have an ASCII character code coding table, I can very easily code any character into its equivalent bits. Now ASCII table is the most used one, but there are certain other tables used, but they are less frequent. In general, you are going to see the situation where most of the time ASCII character coding is used. But another example of character coding table is basically extended binary coded decimal interchange code. Again, the idea here is again the same, only assignment of bits is different here. So same, if you look at this slide, we are having the conversion of characters into bits, but just to give you a quick reminder that this is 6-bit ASCII. In general, standard ASCII tables or the standard ASCII bits that we use for any character coding is basically 8 bits, where 7 bits are for character codes and the last one is for the parity bit. So it means if I go back to this slide, I can have three types of situations here. Either my source is producing analog information, I need to carry out analog to digital conversion process. If I am using the textual information, I need to use ASCII tables to convert or encode that information into sequence of bits. And if I have a digital information, I do not need to process it any further. I can directly send it to the next portion of the transmission. So it means any of the source that I'm going to have definitely will have to fall in any one of these three categories. So whatever my source falls in the category, I am going to do the necessary transformations, and after doing the necessary transformation, I am going to have a bit stream here which I am going to transmit now. So now the next part is the pulse modulation. So let's say I've got whatever the type of source was, I've got my bits in the form of ones or zeros. So if I had the analog source, I converted that to digital format. If I had the textual source, I have converted that using ASCII character coding. And if I had the digital source, it was already creating or generating the bits in digital format, so I do not need to process it any further. So once I have got this thing done, and I have got the data which is basically in the form of bits. Now if I look at these bits, this ones and zeros, which are basically the bits, these are basically only the representation of data without any physical existence, or we can say these are basically the logical data. So if I have to transmit this logical data in real world or in real physical world, then these logical levels or these logical bits should be represented using certain voltage level. So when we convert this logical data into some physical meaning, this is basically the PCM waveform. So generally a bit one is represented by the presence of pulse, and a bit zero is represented by the absence of pulse. So we are going to have this modulation. So when we are going to apply this pulse modulation to the bits obtained from the PCM, we are going to have different types of PCM waveforms. So before we actually go for the types of waveforms, I'm going to go for a little detail on this, the bit time. Whenever we are going to allocate time to a certain bit, it means we need to have a certain voltage level assigned to it, and that voltage level should be contained, should be maintained for certain amount of time, that we call the bit time. Now sometimes the complete bit time is used for representing the voltage level like this situation, or sometimes only the portion of allocated bit time is used, and there are certain advantages of using this situation or this situation. So this perspective is basically that during the bit time, we can either utilize the whole bit time for representing the voltage level, or we can use a portion of that bit time. And definitely it is going to have consequences. It is going to have some positives and negatives for both of these approaches, and we are going to see later on what is the advantage of using the complete bit time or disadvantage of using this thing, and what is the advantage of using this time or this type of format, or what are the disadvantages of using this type of representation. So moving on to PCM waveform, in principle we can categorize these PCM waveforms into four major categories. Number one is non-return to zero, number two is return to zero, number three is phase encoder, and number four is multi-level binary. In general, these waveforms are also used in telephony systems. So sometimes in some literature you are going to find them with the name line codes. So PCM waveforms and line codes are basically two names for one same thing. And there are certain line codes which are applied to non-binary. We are going to see in the end what type of codes are basically used for non-binary. So starting off with the very first one, we have got non-return to zero here. But let me clarify one more thing here. If you look at this thing, we have three subcategories of non-return to zero. One is non-return to zero level, one is non-return to zero mark, and the third one is non-return to zero space. So we need to understand what this level, mark, and space means. So level is any kind of level. It could be a voltage level for 0 bit, or it could be a voltage level for 1 bit. And when we say we are going to have a mark, mark is an old name for binary one. So when I say mark, it means I am saying binary one. And when I say space, it is basically for an old name for binary zero. So when I say space, it is basically nothing but a binary zero here. So we have got three types of waveforms in non-return to zero. One is non-return to zero level, the other one is non-return to zero mark, and third one is non-return to zero space. So starting off with non-return to zero level, we represent a binary one by one voltage level, and the binary zero is represented by another voltage level. So in general, one is represented by positive V volt and a zero is represented by negative V volt. And another thing is that whenever there is a change in level, which means whenever I'm going from 1 to 0 or 0 to 1, there is a change in level is governed by change in data. It means if my data is going from 1 to 0 or 0 to 1, I'm going to change the level. So let's say I'm given a sequence of bit which is something like this: 1011 000 0001, and I am instructed to convert this binary or logical data into non-return to zero level type waveform. So whenever I've got one, I'm going to maintain a level that is positive V. So one is represented by positive V volts, and whenever I'm going to have a zero, I'm going to have negative voltage, that is negative V. So one by positive V, zero by negative V. Then I've got again a one, so data is changing, which says that change in level will be done whenever there is a change in data. So when I'm going from 1 to 0, there is a change in data, so I'm going to change the level from positive V to negative V. Then from going from 0 to 1, I'm going to change the level, I'm going to have positive V. I'm going to maintain the positive V here because I am having two consecutive ones here. So it means there is no change in data. The previous data was 1, the new data is 1, so I'm going to maintain my level at positive V. But when I'm going to have 0 after the second one, then I'm going to change the level and go to negative V. Then I've got 3 consecutive zeros, so I'm going to maintain negative V for 3 consecutive bits. Then there will be change in level whenever I'm going to have 1 again. And then I have another one, 2 neighboring one. I'm not going to change the level because there is no change in data. And whenever I'm then I've got 1 to 0 transition. So 1 to 0 transition is basically from positive V to negative V. And then from 0 to 1, this is from minus V to positive V. So these were some of the bits. But let's say if we are going to have thousands, or let's say 2000 bits, we are going to follow the same sequence for this thing. Then I'm having non-return to zero mark, which says that a binary one or mark is represented by a change in level, and a binary zero space is represented by no change in level. It is also referred to as differential encoding. It is used in magnetic tape recordings. So let's say I have the same sequence of bits and I need to encode them using NRZM. So a binary one is represented by change in level, a binary zero space is represented by no change in level. So assuming that I am having the initial condition that was at negative V, and I have encountered the first bit that is one, so I will change my level from minus V to positive V. So I'm going to have a change in level when I'm going to have one here. Then the second bit is zero. So it says that a binary zero space is represented by no change in level. So I'm going to maintain the same level which I had for the previous bit. So if I'm having a zero, I will maintain the same level. That is why we are having a straight line here. Then the third bit is one. So it means for one, I need to change the level. So I will change the level from positive V to negative V. So then I have got the fourth bit, which is again one. So I'm going to change the level from minus V to positive V. Then I've got three consecutive zeros, and for zero I do not need to change any level, so I will maintain whatever the level I have been maintaining for the previous bit, that was basically this one. And same goes on for all the bits. So one important thing here is if you compare it with non-return to zero level, we are having the bit one represented by positive V volt, and we are having the bit zero represented by negative V volt. But in this case, non-return to zero mark, here one is represented by positive V volt, here one is represented by negative V volts, here one is again represented by negative V volt, here one is represented by positive V volts, here it is represented by positive V volt. So it means, unlike non-return to zero level, in non-return to zero mark, the information is basically not in the level that I am having, but the transition that I'm going to make. So if it is as one, I'm going to make a transition, and if it is zero, I'm not going to make a transition. So it means information here is embedded in the change in the level, not the level itself, which was the case in non-return to zero level. So it means non-return to zero mark, you have to look for the transition. So whenever you are going to have a transition, it means you are going to have a situation where you are going to have the data that is one. And when I talk about non-return to zero space, it is basically the complement of non-return to zero mark, which means whatever I was doing for one in non-return to zero mark, I will be doing it for zero for non-return to zero space. And whatever I was doing for a zero in non-return to zero M, I'll be doing it for one. So a binary zero space is represented by a change in level, and a binary one of mark is represented by no change in level, which means if I look at this thing and assuming the initial condition as negative V, I'm not going to change because I am having the level one, and as per non-return to zero space, I should not change the level if the bit is one, but I have to change the level when the bit is zero. So for second bit, which is zero, I'm going to change the level from minus V to plus V, and same goes on for every bit that we have done or covered lately. This was non-return to zero mark space. Level mark and space, we have got three different types of non-return to zero waveforms. One more thing that you should observe here is that there is no zero level maintained here. So that is why we call it non-return to zero, that this any of these three waveforms is not going to stay at zero in any case. Either it be plus V volt or negative V volt, it will cross the zero, but it will never maintain a zero level, which means non-return to zero will never have any waveform or the level that is going to be maintained at zero volts. That is why it is called non-return to zero. Then we have got return to zero, and we have three different subgroups. One is unipolar RZ, the other one is bipolar RZ, the third one is RZ AMI or RZ alternate mark inversion. It is used in baseband transmission and magnetic recording. So unipolar RZ says that a binary one is represented by a pulse having width equal to half of the bit time, whereas a binary zero is represented by the absence of the pulse. So if I look at the same bit pattern and I want to draw it with unipolar RZ, for one, I'm going to have a half bit white pulse placed in the first half of the bit time, whereas for zero, I will not be having any pulse. So I am having two levels, one is positive V, the other one is zero. So whenever I am having one, I will represent one by a half bit white pulse placed in the first half of the interval, and for zero, I'm not going to have any kind of pulse there, and I'm going to maintain the level zero here. So if you apply this thing, you are going to encode everything like this. So if you look at this, here you have one, you have got a pulse, here you have got one, you have got a pulse, one, you have got a pulse, and so on. Then the second is the bipolar return to zero, where binary ones and zeros are represented by opposite polarity pulses, and all these pulses are half bit wide. So it means for bipolar RZ, I'm going to have half bit white pulse for one that is positive, and for zero I'm going to have the half bit white pulse, but that is having reverse polarity, that is negative V. So for one I'm going to have positive V, for zero I'm going to have negative V, but again these pulses are half bit white pulses, these does not comprise of the complete bit time, and you can encode this thing here. So for everyone you look here, for everyone you have got a positive going pulse that is half bit wide, and for every zero you have got negative going pulse that is again half bit wide. For all the alternate Mach inversion, binary 1s are represented by equal amplitude alternate pulses and binary 0s are represented by the absence of the pulse, and this is used in telephone system. So let's say the same bit pattern is being converted using RZ alternate Mach inversion. So alternate Mach inversion is, it means for every alternate one I have to invert. So in principle, let's say I have this thing, for every one I'm going to place a pulse. That pulse is basically placed in the center of the bit interval, which is something like this, and for zero there will be no pulse. So if I continue like this, I am encountering the second one. Now important thing here is, when I am going to encode this one, I need to have the knowledge of the polarity of the previous pulse that I used for one. So if previously I used the positive amplitude, now I am going to use the negative amplitude. So whatever is the amplitude of the previous pulse, I need to use the opposite amplitude. So here it was positive, now I am going to have a negative. So for next one, I am going to have pulse that is positive. For zero, I do not have any pulse, I am maintaining a zero level, and for one, I am going to have a pulse that is the complement of the previous pulse used for one. So you can say for each one you are having an alternate alternate pulse that is inverted. So first is positive, let's say first is positive, second negative, third is positive, fourth is negative, and so on. So this was returned to zero, and you can see it. So one important thing here is, non-return to zero, we are going to have a zero level here, as you can see in all three waveforms. So that is why we call them return to zero. Then we have got the biphase, and biphase we have three categories: biphase level, biphase mark, and biphase space. And it is used in magnetic recording system, optical communication system, satellite telemetry. So biphase level says that a binary one is represented by a half bit pile bit wide pulse positioned during the first half of the bit interval, whereas a binary zero is represented by a half bit wide pulse positioned during the second half of the bit interval. So one and zero both are represented by half bit wide pulse, but the important thing is their placement. For one, you are going to place that bit in the first half. For zero, you are going to place that bit in the second half. So let's say we have got this binary sequence. So for one, we need to have a pulse that is in the first half, that is half bit wide pulse, so one is here, and for zero we need to have this half bit wide pulse but placed in the second half of the bit interval. So if you see ones here, for every one you have got half bit wide pulse that is placed in the first half of the bit interval, and for zero you are going to have half bit wide pulse which is placed in the second half of the bit interval. Then we have got biphase mark, where biphase mark says that we have a transition that occurs at the start of every bit interval, but for binary one we have a second transition 1/2 bit interval later, whereas binary zero is represented by no second transition. So if I look at this binary pattern, if I want to convert this thing, so let's say I was starting with the initial condition as positive V, and I want to make a transition for one. So I had one transition here, so from positive V I have gone back negative V, but as it is decided, I am going to have a second transition in the middle of the bit interval if my data is one. So this data is one, I'm going to have a second transition. So then I have got the second bit that is zero. So one thing is for sure, that we are going to have a transition that start of every bit interval like this thing. So one is going to have a transition and zero is going to have a transition as well. But what differentiates between one from zero is basically the absence of the pulse in case of zero, second transition. So for zero, I am going to have the first transition here, but I'm not going to have any other transition during the bit interval. I'm going to continue with the negative V. Then I've got the third bit that is one. I'm going to have a transition at the start of the bit interval, and I'm going to have another transition in the middle of the bit interval. So in this case, whenever I've got one or zero, I'm going to have transition anyway in the start of the bit interval. But whenever I've got one, I need to have the second transition in the middle of the bit interval. So definitely this is going to differentiate between 0 and 1 in case of biphase mark. And if I talk about biphase space, it is exactly the opposite, which means for every 1 or every 0, I'm going to have transition in the start of every bit interval, but for 1, I'm not going to have a second transition, and for 0, I'm going to have the second transition. So there are certain parameters of PCM waveform that I leave up to you. It is basically again from the Bernard's law. So you need to check up these parameters, that DC component, self-clocking, error detection, bandwidth compression, and noise immunity that you need to cover yourself. So there are certain PCM waveforms which provide self-clocking, which means you do not need an external clock for synchronization. There are certain PCM waveforms which are having the DC component in them, or they do not have any DC component. There are certain PCM waveforms which are better for error detection, and there are some PCM waveform which are bandwidth efficient, and there are certain waveforms which have better noise immunity as compared to other PCM waveforms. So you need to go through this complete thing, and you need to understand these different parameters of the PCM waveforms. And another thing that you need to do is you need to do the spectral attributes of PCM waveforms as well.